Good morning, and thank you very much for inviting me to this year's Covered Bond Congress. The invitation is very timely as the implementation of the EU Covered Bond Directive is progressing at national level, with the full implementation intended to be in place by mid of next year. I therefore greatly appreciate the opportunity to take stock of where we are, but also highlight what I see as the challenges and possibilities lying ahead for us. We're at a time where the aftermath of COVID-19 is still very much with us. The role of stable financing is of utmost importance, and covered bond instruments have always been of a very special interest to us, given its key role in the financing of many EU economies, but also as a source of long-term funding. As you all know, in recent years, covered bonds have provided a reliable source of funding to banks, also when the appetite for many other types of instruments dried out. By allowing banks to fund long-term assets in a way which is cost-effective and which matches the long-term of their assets, covered bonds contribute to the strength and the stability of the banking system. We therefore continue to put high emphasis on following the developments in the EU covered bond market and to ensure that the legal and supervisory framework is well suited to the importance of this instrument. The adoption of the covered bond directive in 2019 has been a major achievement in this regard. It is very satisfying to see that the joint policy effort provided over so many years finally gave shape to an EU-wide regime, and that this regime mostly builds upon the EBA's analysis and recommendations. The covered bonds legislative package will enhance harmonization in the market, in line with the objectives of the Capital Markets Union. But it will also provide strict eligibility criteria for the preferential regulatory treatment, which is essential to ensure that the favorable prudential treatment provided to covered bonds is applied adequately and fairly across the European Union. It is too early at this stage to conclude about the impact of this new regime on the EU covered bonds market. The deadline for national transposition has expired only recently, and the whole framework will be fully effective next year. However, it appears that the new regime has been successful already in some respects prior to its implementation. By building on the success and principles from those jurisdictions with more established markets, a high-quality benchmark has been provided. By having a harmonized concept in place, it is paving the way for the introduction of covered bond instruments in new markets within but also outside the European Union. The EU covered bonds regime seems to have reduced entry barriers in the market. It also gave the instrument a worldwide recognition of its strategic importance as a long-term funding tool. National transpositions of this new framework still need to be completed. The first half of 2021 saw several European countries passing required legislative acts, but the legal process for ratification in many countries have not got fully underway yet, which may be attributed to some extent to the COVID-19 crisis, but we should keep watching. The transposition into law of certain elements, such as the provisions of understandable maturities and the calculation of liquidity buffers, have proven particularly difficult. That is also because the directive is principles-based on this point, leaving room for interpretation at national level. However, I remain confident that all EU member states will meet their obligation to implement the legislation within the legal timeframe. The full transposition of the EU regime is a prerequisite for the application of the preferential regulatory treatment for covered bonds in each EU jurisdiction. The covered bond regime, therefore, is well on track to becoming a success story, but we must not grow complacent. Despite the good performance during the pandemic, covered bonds will not be immune to deteriorations in credit quality. The credit quality of covered bonds has remained remarkably unimpaired by the COVID-19 crisis, but for how long, it's still unknown. The performance of the collateral has been stable since the beginning of the pandemic, with residential mortgage arrears generally steady. Short-term work schemes and payment holidays seem to have prevented an unemployment surge, as well as borrowers from failing into arrears in their obligations. However, it is uncertain how mortgage loans, especially in the prime and in the commercial real estate segments, will perform in the medium term once the public support will fully vanish. Recent analysis performed by the EBA and published in the context of our EBA stress test tend to show that the loans which have been under moratoria bear higher credit risk compared to other loans. Against this background, it is important that banks continue to closely monitor loan performance, especially in jurisdictions with widespread use of moratoria or that have been particularly hurt by the COVID-19 crisis. This requires that lenders promptly recognize credit deterioration and engage early with problematic borrowers to address their issues. Another clear trend in the area of covered bonds will be the integration of sustainability aspects. Covered bonds were among the first asset classes to embrace the ESG bond market, and the growth potential of sustainable covered bonds could be very strong as mortgage loans are well suited to provide collaterals for these products. Investors' demand also continues to be high, despite the limited pricing differential compared with vanilla, plain vanilla covered bond issue. As a result, sustainable covered bonds now represent a notable share of new covered bond issuance, almost 70% of overall issuance in 2021 so far. That being said, a lot of work still needs to be done in this area. Similarly to other types of debt instruments, alignment with EU taxonomy, compliance with the EU green bond standards, and bridging the data gap, especially with the aim of creating harmonized disclosure requirements, will be significant challenges. On top of that, the lack of high-quality, energy-efficient buildings to fit into the cover pool also constitutes a major limitation for the market at present. However, the effort made by the covered bond market industry to build a label, the Energy Efficient Mortgage Label, and to gather data through the Energy Efficient Mortgage Initiative already constitute very positive steps. That being said, we will all have a lot of work to do in this area in the years to come still. With these challenges, I want to conclude with some broad thoughts on the topic, where I see the two main contributions from the EBA for covered bonds going forward. First of all, and most importantly, I would say, the Commission's renewed strategy on sustainable finance has given the EBA an additional mandate in relation to green bonds. The EBA will prepare an opinion on the definition and possible supporting tools for green retail loans and green mortgages by the second quarter of next year. In that context, the work undertaken by the EMF ECBC will be a natural component. Further work on social and sustainability-linked bonds is also envisaged by 2022. Second, as regards to the implementation of the covered bond directive, while no EBA intervention is planned at this stage, EBA will provide a comprehensive review of the implementation of the new framework by 2025, as requested by the EU co-legislators in the covered bonds directive. In this regard, the EBA will, as always, engage with industry stakeholders, as these tasks have to be done in collaboration with the industry in order to be successful. Thank you very much for your attention.
Hello, my name is Victoria Benn, and I'm Commercial Director for Euromoney and Global Capital Conference. Thank you very much, José Manuel, for your fascinating speech and for joining us today at the Euromoney ECBC Covered Bond Congress. We have a bit of time in the agenda, so I'm going to ask José Manuel a few questions. Some banks that we speak to seem to be quite complacent about the funding that they get from retail deposits, in particular in light of greater saving rates over the last year. Are you worried about deposit risk flight as a risk factor in the banking system?
Well, first of all, thank you very much for having me to the conference, Victoria. It's a real pleasure.
Thank you.
And apologies for not being able to be in person with you. It's true that over the last year, there's been an increase in the savings rates, you know, but the analysis that we have and we hear from the central banks is that a big increase in the savings rates has been transitory, you know, and it's likely to be fading out as the recovery continues, and particularly households, you know, reinitiate their spending, and there's some bump up demand that is coming up. So we think that will be a relatively small transitory effect. More relevant, but perhaps, is the environment in which we are working, and we've been working for a few years with very low interest rates, that of course makes deposits, savings as a relatively low interest or low earning opportunity and alternative. But I must say that over the crisis, over the medium term, and I think going forward as well, you know, the resilience of the deposit funding has been high, so that gives me confidence.
Some have argued that the proposed flaw on the risk weight calculations from IRB models disincentivizes low risk lending by banks with sophisticated risk models, and will A, favor higher risk lending, and B, make low risk assets such as mortgages more expensive for the borrower. What do you say to that argument?
Well, I think that one of the key successes of the negotiations in the Basel, this argument has a lot to do with the Basel reforms, the implementation of the Basel reforms. So one of the key successes from my perspective on the finalization of the Basel agreement was the preservation of the risk sensitivity of the pricing and of the models in assessing prudential capital requirements. So that preservation remains. So I'm confident that although there was a floor that was implemented, that floor, as we all know, is an upper floor, and it's really a backup solution, you know, to assure that there is sufficient provision of capital for other for addressing adequate risk. So I do not think that really there will be any significant, you know, fear that banks will engage in higher risk-taking activities because of the implementation of the reform, or in particular of the output floor, as you suggest. On the contrary, I think that banks have always been good at assessing risks, and that's the task, making sure that adequate provision of risk will be provided for when they grant a loan. And I can't imagine that them decided that they want to just provide riskier loans, you know, just because they don't have to appropriate regulatory capital. At the end of the day, they don't care about regulatory capital, they care about their economic capital and their actual losses. So I'm sure they'll act prudently.
Good point. So plenty of studies have now demonstrated a correlation between the probability of default on a mortgage and the energy efficiency of the home funded by it. Will this correlation be taken into account in capital rules in the future?
Well, that's to me, that's a very interesting evidence, you know, and that's exactly the type of evidence that we need to start building up as we work through how to integrate into the capital, the prudential requirements and the regulation overall, you know, the energy efficiency and more the climate and sustainability component aspects of any loan. You know, because it's very important for us that any kind of prudential requirements have to be risk-based as we go forward. So building up that evidence of what are the implicit risk in this type of loans is very important going forward. As you said in your question, this is just a correlation, it's not a causality. Right, so that correlation may be linked to other aspects as well. For instance, you know, it could be that more energy efficient households also have higher incomes, and therefore they have an overall lower probability of default just because of the higher income. So it needs to be further analyzed, but I think it's going in the right direction. It's certainly, you know, suggestive, and we should be exploring it. And as far as I say, and as I say in my initial remarks, you know, as we work through our mandate for the second quarter of next year on providing potential prudential benefits for mortgage lending in energy efficient lending or energy efficient housing, I should say, you know, this the type of evidence that we need to look at carefully and make sure that we assess properly. So it's encouraging, and I encourage very much that kind of work continues going forward.
Yeah, it's fascinating. José Manuel, thank you so much for joining us today. I hope that we can meet in real life soon. But in the meantime, thank you very much, and we look forward to seeing you again. Thank you.
Thank you, and thank you again for having me. It's been a pleasure.